जयराम रमेश जी।
आदरणीय उपसभापति महोदय,
एक मिनट, सूचना के लिए लेख करने के बाद ही सर्कुलेट होता है जो नियम है उसमें, इसलिए दैट्स ऑल।
आदरणीय उपसभापति महोदय
जी,
अस्माभिः अधुना विचार्यमाणं अविलम्बेन च स्वीकरिष्यमाणं इदं विधेयकं संस्कृतभाषस्य भूरितरं साहाय्यं करिष्यति।
Please,
this bill that we are about to discuss and will soon pass will greatly help the cause of the Sanskrit language. Idam vidhayakam vartamanani trini sanskrit sansthani kendre vishwavidyalayatvena parinamyate. This bill converts three existing Sanskrit institutions into central universities. Aham swayameva तेषु अन्यतमं तिरुपति स्थितौ राष्ट्रीय संस्कृत विद्यापीठम अगमम्। I myself have been visiting the National Sanskrit University, the deemed university in Tirupati, which will soon become a central university because of this bill. उपसभापति महोदयाः, संस्कृतं सर्वदा केषाञ्चिदेव आधिपत्ययस्य विषयः अत्येतत् Dukhavaha. Sanskrit has always been the monopoly of a few, and that is a matter of great sadness and tragedy for India. Adhuna bahunam sampada bhavitavyam. We have to make this monopoly of the few into the treasure of the many, and that is what this bill should hope to accomplish. Sir, Sanskrit has enriched Indian languages, and many Indian languages have contributed to Sanskrit. Sanskrit is part of our legacy. We are proud of the legacy. However, we should not forget that this beautiful language, this scientific language, this magnificent language has also been the instrument of caste oppression, of caste discrimination and caste subjugation. This is also part of the Sanskrit legacy. We have a glorious legacy of Sanskrit, and we also have a very disquieting and a very unfortunate legacy that it was used as an instrument by human beings to subjugate large sections of our society. So in our eagerness to promote Sanskrit, we should not ignore the troubled history of this language. Sanskrit is not spoken by many people, sir. Hardly 15,000 people in India speak Sanskrit. Hardly 15,000 people
please
in India speak Sanskrit.
Bolna allow nahi. Please, bhai, you are senior member.
Sanskrit is not the spoken language. It has been the language of priests. It has been the language of the courts. But it's not been the popular language. Buddha preached in Magadhi. The Bhakti movement took place in regional languages. However, since Sanskrit is part of our cultural legacy, we take pride in it. So on the 3rd of February 2020, there was an unstarred question in Parliament. This is unstarred question number 171 in the Lok Sabha. And the question asked the Minister of Culture, what was the expenditure on Sanskrit and what was the expenditure on other classical Indian languages? And I want to give this information to this house because we are in danger of giving greater importance to Sanskrit that it deserves at the cost of other regional languages. So the answer by the Minister of Culture on the 3rd of February 2020 reveals that in the last 3 years, last 3 years, the government of India spent 640 crores on the popularization of Sanskrit. But look at the expenditure on other classical Indian languages. The government of India spent 24 crores on Tamil, 3 crores on Telugu, 3 crores on Kannada, and 0 in Malayalam and Odia. These are the 6 classical Indian languages of India: Sanskrit, Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, Malayalam, and Odia. We have spent 650 crores on Sanskrit, 24 crores on Tamil, 3 crores on Kannada, 3 crores on Telugu, and 0 in Malayalam and Odia. This completely negates the policy which we have to follow. These are languages spoken by millions and millions of people. Tamil is not a language of Tamil Nadu alone. It's a national language. Kannada is not a language of Karnataka alone. It's a national language. Malayalam is a national language. Odia is a national language. Telugu is a national language. These are spoken by millions of people. But for a language that is spoken by 15,000 people, we are spending 650 crores. This is the admission by the Minister of Culture alone. Sir, we may not like this, but this is a fact that historically, Sanskrit has always been the elite language. I find my friend Bhupinder Yadav is shaking his head. Let me remind him what Valmiki Ramayana says when Hanuman is seeing Sita for the first time in Lanka. Hanuman tells himself, and I want to quote from the Valmiki Ramayana: Yadi vacham pradasyami dvijatiriva sanskritam ravanam manyamana mam sita bhita bhavishyati. If I speak like Sanskrit, if I speak in Sanskrit, Sita will get frightened thinking that I am Ravana. This is what Hanuman says, and this is what Valmiki says in Ramayana Sundarakanda. Hanuman goes on to say, avashyam eva vaktavyam manusham vakyam arthavat. I will therefore speak only in the language of the people. Even Hanuman didn't speak in Sanskrit to Sita. He spoke in the language of the people. And I wish this government speaks in the language of the people and spends more money for Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, Odia, Malayalam, not spending money only in Sanskrit, because that is a very distorted picture of Indian civilization. Sir, on the bill, I have 2 points. First, there are 3 institutions: Rashtriya Sanskrit Vidyapeeth in Tirupati, the Lal Bahadur Shastri Sanskrit Vidyapeeth in Delhi, and the Rashtriya Sanskrit Sansthan in New Delhi. I want to make one suggestion to the Honorable Minister. The greatest name in Sanskrit grammar, the man who invented Sanskrit grammar, who is considered even a genius today by everybody, who lived in the 7th century BC, was Panini. I would request the Honorable Minister to name one of these institutions after Panini. Panini, after all, was born in the Northwest Frontier Province. Whether he would be eligible under CAA or not is a separate issue. But by naming one institution after Panini, we would be recognizing this great man who made Sanskrit what it is today. And it would also give a signal that Sanskrit is not India's legacy, it's not Hindu legacy, but it's a legacy of the entire subcontinent. Secondly, sir, the second institution I would suggest to the Honorable Minister, the second big name in Sanskrit grammar is Patanjali. Yes. Unfortunately, if you name an institution today after Patanjali, it will send the wrong signals. So I will not recommend Patanjali. There is a third name who we all students of Sanskrit have learnt when we were in school: the Ashtadhyayi and the Amarkosha. Panini's Ashtadhyayi and the Amarkosha of Amarasimha. And Amarasimha lived in Ujjain in the 3rd century AD. And I would request the Honorable Minister to name the second institution after Amar Simha and not Patanjali. So one institution after Panini and one institution after Amar Simha. Finally, sir, these three central universities will add to the 40 central universities that are under the Ministry of Human Resource Development. However, the track record of managing central universities is pathetic in the last few years. JNU has been destroyed. Allahabad University is being destroyed. So the notion that by becoming a central university, suddenly things will be set right has been proved wrong. And I would therefore seriously urge the Honorable Minister to give a thought to the governance structure for these central universities, to liberate the central universities from the stranglehold of the Ministry of Human Resource Development. Why should the minister be the chancellor of this central university? Why can't he find a distinguished Sanskrit scholar to be the chancellor? Divest your resources so that these universities can be run independently and professionally. I think this is a step in the right direction. These three institutions were started between 1960 and 1970. These are not new institutions. They were started, in fact, thanks to Maulana Azad, Jawaharlal Nehru, and Dr. Radhakrishnan. These were the three people who were responsible for these three institutions in a way, and they were set up between 1961 and 1970. We are converting them into central universities. It's a good step forward, and I hope that the Honorable Minister will respond to some of the suggestions I have made in a constructive spirit. Thank you, sir.